I'd like to welcome you to the Charter Review Committee's second public forum. I have the privilege to serve as the chair of the Charter Review Committee, along with the members of our committee listed here. Oops, sorry. Yeah, here. I have to do this myself tonight. Our committee has representatives from the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee, and the Appropriation Committee, as well as four members of the public, one of whom served on the original Charter Commission. During our forum, we will be reviewing the proposed changes we are recommending to the Charter, including background and support, and seeking input and or answering questions from residents or people in attendance. Comments may be made in person here or by emailing me at pwaxlax@hopkintonma.gov. I would like to remind everyone in town that all of our meetings are public and posted in advance, and we welcome public comment at the beginning of every meeting. In addition, we have a page on the town website which has a link to our files, including approved minutes, the 2006 charter, the proposed charter, and public presentations we have made to date. The committee began the process of reviewing the existing charter in January 2016 with an in-depth review of the existing charter and a review of comments and recommendations received by Town Hall since the charter was first implemented in 2006. We investigated charters of 17 benchmark communities, which, like Hopkinton, have charter rule and open town meeting and similar demographics. We also interviewed town boards and committees and department heads within town government to gather input they had regarding the charter. In September 2016, we held a public forum to gather input from the residents. Our task in the end is to look at all input and feedback and recommend the best possible solution to keep our town's government efficient and effective. A careful review of all this input has led us to the proposed changes we are proposing tonight. The first task we set for ourselves was to determine the organizational structure of the proposed charter itself so that items similar in nature were grouped together. At the same time, we evaluated those items which were no longer applicable or could be omitted. The table of contents at the front of the proposed charter illustrates the original order, where the section was moved or if it was omitted, and the proposed order. The main rationales for omitting sections were either because the original section related to transition for the 2006 charter upon adoption, or the section duplicated either Massachusetts general laws or town bylaws. In both instances, the sections were no longer necessary to be carried forward in the proposed charter. We wanted to ensure that all proposed elected positions were specifically defined and that any administrative orders and special acts were also incorporated into the proposed charter if necessary. Since the 2006 charter, the town manager implemented an administrative order establishing the Library Board of Trustees in order for the town to purchase the physical building from the former library trustees and obtain state grant money for its expansion project. Additionally, the special acts relating to the Department of Public Works, originally approved in 1998, 2006, and 2010 by both town meeting and the state legislature, were incorporated into the proposed charter. Finally, the committee agreed the section on periodic charter review should be clarified as there was some ambiguity in the wording in the original charter. When organizing the proposed charter, the committee felt the following groupings would best capture the different roles in town government. Incorporation, existence, and authority are the primary defining principles of the proposed charter. The legislative branch captures town meeting in its various pieces, including the warrants, the town moderator, rules and procedures, and the appropriation committee. The executive branch captures the Board of Selectmen, town manager, town clerk, and DPW special act. Other elected boards and committees specifically identifies elected boards and committees, including composition and term of office, powers and duties, and appointments if applicable. Elections include the town election and recall provision. Administrative organization includes organization of town departments and removals, loss of office and excess absence, or notice of vacancies for appointed boards or committee members. Financial and fiscal procedures defines the fiscal year, submission of the budget, capital improvements, and audits. And general provisions is information specific to the proposed charter, including timing of the periodic charter review. The goal of all the proposed significant changes is to streamline town government, to make board and committee structure more consistent, and to enable an efficient and effective town government capable of meeting evolving responsibilities and demands. And I'll speak to each one individually. The committee evaluated comparison data and solicited feedback regarding an elected versus an appointed town clerk and proposed the change based on this. Benefits of keeping the town clerk elected were independence and autonomy. Mm-hmm. Voters have direct control over who serves. It guarantees a Hopkinton resident in the position. It's subject to the recall provision of the charter. It is the town clerk is the face of the town to many residents. Benefits for making the position appointed were you can match the skill set against requirements. It's part of the salary administration plan. It's subject mm-hmm. to performance management oversight by the Board of Selectmen. Part of the formal reporting structure, can require the town clerk to obtain and retain certifications, can oversee every election as not on the ballot once every 3 years, likely a larger pool of candidates, and there's a potential to have language giving preference to Hopkinton residents for this. Mm-hmm. The committee unanimously felt the town clerk should be appointed, but also recognized that the position is unique in town hall and should still be independent. As such, we felt oversight by the Board of Selectmen, who are directly elected by the town, would be preferred to oversight by the town manager. The town clerk's responsibilities would remain unchanged from current practice, including the ability to appoint, supervise, set goals, evaluate, and discipline the assistant town clerk. Finally, no appointment shall become effective prior to the 2019 annual town election, which is the end of the current town clerk's term, unless a vacancy occurs in the office prior to that date. We looked at five areas relating to reporting structure: appointment, supervision, goal setting, evaluation, and discipline. After input from all impacted boards and discussion by the committee, we recommend that this reporting structure should be considered for the town planner, the library director, the parks and recreation director, the board of health agent, and the conservation administrator. It should be noted that each board or commission will still have ultimate appointing and hiring authority over its town employees, and staff currently employed in these positions will remain in them. The goal setting will happen with the full input from and approval by the board or commission in an open public meeting that will drive the day-to-day supervision overseen by the town manager. This latter part allows for better town-wide planning among departments while ensuring board-specific goals are addressed as well. Specifically, the charter states the town manager's supervisory authority shall be consistent with programmatic policy direction from the employee's appointing authority. The employee would continue to interact with the corresponding board or commission when such public body meets. Evaluation will be completed by the town manager after seeking input from individual board members, which doesn't necessarily require an open meeting. Part of this is to ensure that all town employees receive an evaluation annually. Another factor is related to open meeting law. One of the legal issues that has come up in another town is that boards or committees may not request input for a review outside an open meeting, as this has been deemed a violation of open meeting law. For example, a chair may not send out a form requesting comments on an employee's performance prior to a meeting in order to gather input in one document for that meeting. This practice may still be followed, however, if the person requesting the information to be gathered is not part of the board or committee, for example, the town manager. If the evaluation is to be discussed by the entire board, it must be done in an open meeting. Finally, discipline will be done by the town manager, subject to the right of the employee to appeal any decision to the board or commission. Discipline does include termination. Our committee originally discussed giving that authority to the appointing authority directly, but upon further review, realized that the town manager would need to be able to act immediately when the situation calls for it. Since the right of appeal to the board or commission still exists, it does mean that the board or commission has ultimate say in the decision through the appeal process if the employee chooses to go that route. This will allow for all town employees to be treated fairly and consistently, held to the same standards, offered the same working condition, and also retain the authority of the appointing board and commission. When reviewing the budget process, the committee kept in mind that the town is continuously growing, and as of fiscal year ending June 30, 2017, it had an $80 million budget across all aspects of town finances. The 2006 charter provides specific due dates for deliverables as part of the budget process, which has caused issues as annual town meeting approached with regards to providing information in advance of annual town meeting. The same deliverables are still identified and included in the proposed charter. However, no specific dates other than the town manager establishing and issuing a budget schedule with the agreement of the Board of Selectmen, the school committee, and the appropriation committee no later than October 1st are present. These three committees are the most impacted by the budget schedule and as such need to be included in the establishment of the timeline for deliverables. This allows more flexibility for meeting the ultimate deadline of annual town meeting and the preparation of an annual appropriation committee report 14 days prior to annual town meeting. The annual appropriation committee report shall include recommendations and detailed explanations of all financial articles. The additional change of closing the warrant 90 days before annual town meeting rather than 60 days should also allow for better preparation of the warrant articles and motions document. The intention of warrant articles, the initiation of warrant articles, such as by department head, majority of board or committee, and citizen petition, remains unchanged in the proposed charter. Finally, recognizing the need to more carefully plan and monitor capital improvements across the town, the related section has been clarified. The capital improvements program shall be designed to address unmet long-range needs and to implement the capital goals and objectives of the town, and shall include all town activities, all town departments, including the school department, and all enterprise funds. This 10-year plan will be updated annually and shall include cost estimates, potential methods of financing, and recommended time schedules for each improvement, as well as the estimated annual cost of operating and maintaining each facility and item of major equipment involved. The committee understands that this is a guideline and issues may arise that would require changes between annual reviews of the plan. At this time, I would like to invite the public to ask questions and/or provide comments with regards to the proposed charter. If you're present, please speak at the microphone so the viewers at home may hear you and state your name and address. Anyone watching at home or later on a rebroadcast may email me at pwaxlax@hopkintonma.gov.
Is this a public hearing or is this a public deliberation?
It's a public forum.
So will there be deliberation or is it just going to be?
It's to get feedback from the public as well as answer questions that maybe if it's not coming, something isn't clear in the charter, we can probably expand upon it a little bit better. And it's also to allow us to continue to deliberate at our next meeting, taking in the input that we've received tonight.
Deliberate amongst the team and not amongst the community. I mean, I guess what I'm trying to figure out is, let's say a point comes up that's somewhat contentious. Are we going to have a debate this evening, which can be healthy, but are we going to have that, or are we just going to take that under advisement, and then the group's going to debate it internally before we come to town meeting, or?
Advisement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does it make sense?
I think advisement.
I just want to understand how
so there's not
tonight.
Back and forth.
No, it's okay to have back and forth, but what are the expectations of what we're going to do tonight, I guess is what I'm trying to understand.
No decisions will be made tonight, but we're seeking
says the
input.
Man must bring in the air.
Yes. I'm a good puppet, right?
Okay, great. Thank
Didn't
you.
Even see him speak.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I mean, you could say the ultimate vote is at town meeting, right?
True enough.
So, not tonight.
I'm first. Actually, second. Darlene Hayes, 1/3 Road, Hopkinton. My first is a comment, and it's not a good one. I was at the first public forum, and pretty similar group, a few extra people here tonight, but not much more. And comments that we heard coming back to the people that were there was it was the same old people, same old input. We're going to move forward with what we want and how we're already deciding, regardless of the input from that. After reading this red line draft that I saw, not one bit of input that came from that night was actually implemented at all. Not one word, not a comment, nothing in the red line. So it seemed like the last public forum, we were the same old, We represented a couple different parties. We represented some young voters. We represented some seasoned voters. But it was very much taken as a criticism, and it came back through several different people that we heard this.
So
that was my comment on tonight. Are you actually going to take input and feedback from this group here, that we would actually see something in writing and see some sort of change?
Just to clarify, so we did take input from the last public forum, and we did evaluate it. What we are charged with is to ensure that we have an efficient and effective town hall. So while taking it into account, a lot of what I heard, and this is a personal thing, mm-hmm. was that the charter was fine and we didn't need to change it. So if you could give me specifics what you think would be a good change, then we can take note of that and address it.
I think seeing the charter, I've never seen a document so redlined. And if the charter is the constitution of the town, you know, a current president and a cabinet wouldn't come in and rewrite the whole thing. They'd amend it, they may tweak things. And what I saw was pretty much a rewrite. And I mean, I've never seen so many red lines, and that it seemed like none of the input from the last time. And I know we were the same old, but I mean, that came out very clear and back public feedback is that, you know, our input didn't really matter.
Can I comment?
Sure.
Darlene, I don't view it that the input was not considered, but I think that there's a broad scope of what we've done to come up with the proposed changes. Mm-hmm. I know Pam highlighted before I got here how many other similar towns that we have looked at and how much work went into that in comparing all sorts of things through other charters, every minute detail.
Right.
So I guess when we say we're looking for public input, it doesn't mean everything you want you get.
Right,
and
I understand
because
that.
There's a lot of things to weigh, there are other people. There's the public, there are the people that work in town hall, there's elected boards and committees, and we have talked to all of those people, and the goal is to sort of blend out all the input and come up with what we think is the best solution, not to write down specific recommendations and just say, okay, they go in.
No, I understand I've been very open with Pam on concerns I've had here and there, and I think it's more how it's coming across. It's like, well, these are things how, I mean, honestly, the whole town clerk thing, whether it's appointed or elected kind of thing back and forth, I'm like, well, I think a couple of years ago that came up at town meeting, we said no. Came up again last year at town meeting, we said no. We had an opposing candidate that had said he only wanted the job to hold it for appointment, and the town overwhelmingly said no, we didn't want that. And it's like, here it is again.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you know off the top of your head what percentage of other towns have appointed town clerks?
That's
irrelevant. Also, the fact that when you did the comparison to other towns, you only did other towns with charters. So you didn't actually do similar towns that surrounded us. So you didn't do every single town that surrounded us. Like, that kind of caught me. Like, you didn't do Southboro, Ashland, Westboro.
We did Ashland.
Yeah, so you handpicked ones that you felt
and
like.
And Westboro.
You didn't do Southboro.
No,
didn't do Upton. You didn't do Milford. Like, if I would take, you know, you didn't do the extreme surroundings, but then I see things that were compared to North Andover or Natick, and that have their whole demographic makeup is a lot different than us. One has universities, and one has a lot more business and commercial base.
Ray, do you want to answer that? Since the towns were provided based on research that was done, that they were demographically similar. That was the goal.
Yeah. So the initial, is this one? Yeah. So the initial choice of the benchmark communities was based on similar size towns, with similar income and a similar character.
North Andover, Natick.
That's right.
Natick is not one of them, I don't believe.
No, I don't think so.
No.
North Andover definitely was on the list.
Yes. The state characterizes each town as an emerging suburb or a developed suburb, and so we were looking for emerging suburbs roughly the same distance from Boston, with similar income and a similar
Definitely not the same commercial base or, you know, secondary institution.
Well, let him finish because there's a little bit more, too.
So, that's the list that we started with.
Mm-hmm.
The committee then said they wanted to add the communities that are nearby that also have charters. Now, obviously, we're looking at comparison charters, so looking at towns that don't have charters wouldn't provide much much input for us. So that's how those were picked.
If a town, I have one clarifying question. If a town doesn't have a charter, could they have a bylaw that allows for an appointed town clerk, or does the town clerk need to be elected?
No, there is a statutory process that allows the various elected officials to become appointed by vote at a ballot question. So a number of towns have used that to change treasurer or town clerk or a few other officials to appointed rather than elected without having a whole charter.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Ken Deeks, 44 Alexander Road. The question I have is related to the previous speaker or the previous questioner, and that is how are the comments made in this meeting recorded? Are they just arbitrarily recorded by individuals, or is there some kind of formal recording process to note what people are thinking, at least coming out of these meetings, such that others may review them and discuss them?
I can answer that right now. So each member is usually taking minutes. This also goes up on HCAM's site, so we also review the meeting after the fact. In our next meeting, the meeting subsequent to the first forum, mm-hmm. we had a list of all the comments that were
okay.
made and are recorded in there, and we discussed those.
Now, you were saying that you decided on issues, you looked at those and decided which were important, which were not. Were those matched up with the comments made? In other words, is there a comment and then your determination, your group's determination on that comment?
Not that I recall. We have taken input throughout the process, and using the input that we've received, have made decisions based on that and the analysis that we've also done outside of the input too.
So the only way to know what's happening is to review the charter that you're proposing on the next date, and going through it line by line to see what comments were affected and what comments weren't. Is that the idea?
All of our minutes are up there, so uh-huh. it's, you know, you can go to the minutes too.
Okay.
Can I say one thing? Mm-hmm. All comments were listened to and considered, but I mean, all comments don't necessarily end up in the charter.
No, that's not the point.
Do you know what I'm saying? Did we look at them? Absolutely, we looked at them.
And do you feedback what you thought of those comments?
Yes, that's what we do at every meeting. We go around the table and we each weigh in on whether we think, you know, the recommendation is good, valid, not good. There's really a lot of discussion among the different members.
And I can give one example. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, one of the positions we looked at was the cemetery commission.
Yeah.
And there was overwhelming evidence to consider changing it, but because of the input, we figured we'd focus on the one that we thought that was the most important. But we definitely, there were several other smaller positions that we, if we were building the town from scratch and yeah. we didn't have a history, we would definitely have gone appointed. But because of the input we got at the last forum, we decided to take that into consideration. So we definitely did that.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Laura Hansen, 19 North Mill Street. I'm a Parks and Rec Commissioner, and I am. My question is, what precipitated this rewrite in terms of the efficiency of our department? I feel like this rewrite of the charter will affect how we operate efficiently. I get that the town is growing, but our department is also growing. and it's operating really efficiently and now mm-hmm. between the commission and our director. And I would like to know what precipitated this rewrite of how, I mean, specifically this, the department that I work in, is going to be very affected by this charter rewrite and how our department operates. And right now we are operating really efficiently and we have expanded our effect on the community and we have adapted to the growing needs of the community. I am just concerned that this rewrite will compromise the efficiency of the Parks and Rec Commission and the way we operate. And so I would like to know what precipitated this rewrite. Was there something we weren't doing right? I mean, I'm just a little confused.
So when I'm going to address it from a Parks and Rec and also a bigger perspective as well. So when we looked at town employees that directly support a elected or appointed board or commission and work with them, we wanted to ensure that there was consistency across all town employees, that they would receive annual evaluation, that they would be held to the same standards regardless of where they worked in the department. It's not that any department wasn't performing well by any stretch of the imagination, but as the town continues to grow, we want to be able to better manage across departments and not necessarily always have to wait for a board meeting in order to affect that change. It's our belief that while day-to-day supervision will change, the board or commission will still be setting the programmatic policy, the setting the goals and how the department that they are affiliated with work. And by doing that, they still have all the control they've had before in terms of setting programs and whatnot.
I guess I don't know the wording of the charter in terms of is Parks and Rec going to be subject to approval from town manager in order to enact any of their activities?
Absolutely not.
Well, okay.
And it doesn't say that it will in the charter either.
Okay. All right. Well, the efficiency of our commission, it works the way it works right now. It works really well. And the way our director of Parks and Rec works and the commission works, our Parks and Rec director is beholden to us every single week. Right. He is beholden to us, on a weekly basis.
And he can continue to be.
Exactly.
He can continue to be.
Well, I want him to be able to operate autonomously without having to be subject to approval from the town manager.
One of the things that we're trying to get away from is there have been instances like that with various boards and committees with direct reports where the direct reports weren't receiving direction from the boards and committees, and they weren't operating as smoothly as Parks and Rec is right now. So that's not fair to the employee, and it's not fair to the taxpayers, because there's no accountability at that point. So what we tried to do is take a look at the roles, and we're trying to deal with the positions rather than the personalities. So the personalities on the Parks and Rec board and in the position of Director of Parks and Rec right now, they're working great. Nobody's going to argue with that. 5 years from now, could be a different director, could be different people on the board. We don't know the same.
To your point, the town manager could change too.
Can I finish?
Sorry.
So nobody knows that that's going to be the same. So we're trying to have something that's repeatable. And in the case of the town manager does still report to another board. So if the town manager is starting to throw wrench into the gears, then he's going to be accountable for that. But this section of the charter that is being considered in no way, in no way allows the town manager to mandate what the programmatic principles or goals are going to be for that Parks and Rec director. It's still up to Parks and Rec.
Can I comment as well?
Sure.
I wanted to answer one of your other questions because you asked several times what precipitated or what caused this
rewrite. Yes.
Okay. It's not a rewrite directed specifically at Parks and Rec, as Todd pointed out, but the charter, per the regulations and the way it's set up, every 10 years gets reviewed and gets updated. That's what precipitated this change. And it's like, it's across the board. It's not your particular department or someone else's department, quote, doing something wrong. It's part of the 10-year review of the charter, which is the self-governing document of the town and how everything works.
I get that. But
so that's what did it.
There's a difference between amending something and tweaking something.
Which is what we're doing. We're not rewriting the whole thing.
It seems like a rewrite.
Well, it's because there were a lot of errors in the first one, to be fair, okay? That not errors. There's just like little things that didn't make sense. A lot of the redlining is because of those minute changes. Some of it is wording, the way things are phrased. That's why there's a lot of red lines. But I really don't think...
Reorganization.
Yeah, it is. It's a lot of the stuff is staying the same. I definitely don't see it as a complete rewrite. It is clearly an amendment. It's a lot of reading to compare the two, I'll give you that. But that doesn't mean that it's being redone.
And
I think our largest...
A lot of power has been put into the town manager's hands that was not there before. And, you know, the way our town operated before was with a lot of different committees and commissions and selectmen and different entities, and it feels like you're rewriting our town constitution, and that I'm sorry, that's just the way it feels to me. So I will review it. And
can I tie this back to the earlier question about incorporating comments and whatnot of feedback that we got from the last forum? This is one of the areas when we were comparing to other town charters, a lot of other towns' parks and rec directors do report directly to the town manager. And as part of our discussions, we definitely reflected on the fact that we heard loud and clear from people at the last forum that it's very important in Hopkinton to maintain the elected boards and the authority of the elected boards. And so what we have tried to do here is combine the management ability for the smooth running and comparable working conditions for all of the town employees without taking away from the authority of the boards that are in place, that are elected by the community, to appoint them, to review them, to set their goals, to dictate what their daily work is. So that's how we arrived at this compromise, I guess, if you will. Because we absolutely heard loud and clear at the other forums and from our conversations with all of the boards that they did not want these particular positions that we're talking about now only to report directly to the town manager. That they didn't want to give that up, and we also agree that that's important. So I just wanted to tie sort of those two things together.
Okay. The wording is very different, saying input from the town manager versus approval from the town manager. Those are two very different wordings, you know, in terms of autonomy of our commission. We will take input from the town manager,
right,
but we know what we're doing, and, you know,
the goals are set,
approval is, that's a problem.
The approval is by your board?
It's not by the town manager.
Yeah.
All right. Well, okay.
Can I make one more comment?
Just reread it.
Read it. Okay.
I have one further comment. Sorry, before you leave.
Please.
You used the word autonomous. I think also we look at boards working together and everyone working together. So I don't know that we see anyone as completely autonomous. We wouldn't want that. We would want everyone to work together. And that's why we, like, as Jean said, we tried to sort of come to a compromise of not taking away the power of the elected boards, but having some sort of control so that everything worked together more efficiently.
Yeah, and it's true. I mean, we don't operate autonomously. We operate, you know, within the confines of the demands of the school system and everybody and the needs of the community. Right. Mm-hmm. That's what we do. But to limit the efficiency of our department, that's what I'm concerned about.
I don't see it.
How would you define efficiency, by the way?
Efficiency is our director being able to run his programs on his own with his staff. That's very important to me, and not having to, you know, jump through hoops with the town manager in order to or get approval. You know, that concerns me.
Yeah, I don't. I think by setting up, when you do goal setting, establishing that as one of the goals is to continue to look at new programs and investigate new programs and open new programs. If that's a goal, it has to be followed by the town manager then too, because that's one of the goals for the director.
Well, and back to your point, like, it is, there's a personality, you know. Our town manager is our town manager right now, but in 5 years, is he still going to be our town manager? It could be another person.
Yeah.
People change.
Right. And the same with Parks and Rec director too. So
exactly.
Right.
Exactly. So that's something to, you know, take into consideration when you're giving somebody an amount of power. That person may not be there. 5 years from now. So that's something to take into consideration in general.
And we absolutely did. Yeah. And you know, one of the tremendous benefits that we had was having Beth on the committee, who was here through, she was on the first Charter Commission. And so she, you know, has that historical reference of a lot of the conversations that were taking place and a lot of the input from the public. And at that point, one of the focal points of the Charter was to bring in a town manager and to centralize the town's government more, and also start to bring in a more professional government. And so with that, you know, it's one of those difficult things where, you know, when you're changing something, you can't just say that this piece is going to change without other roles around it changing as well. So one of the things that we're trying to do is we're trying to plan for the future. We're trying to continue that theme of the Charter, and we're trying to have the government be more centralized but also more standardized, and so that whether it's one person in a position or it's another person in a position, at least the structure can be justified. And then it's up to those elected boards to make sure that they're hiring people who are going to act in the manner that they want. So if it is a new town manager in 5 years and the Board of Selectmen doesn't hire somebody who's going to basically uphold the will of the people and of the Board of Selectmen, then that person shouldn't be the town manager anymore, and they made a mistake in the hire.
So to your point, can you tell me what precipitated the need to centralize the government of the town? Like, what precipitated this need?
Well, so part of it was bringing it to a more professional point. You get to a point, and I wasn't involved in the conversations, 10, 11 years ago, but you get to a point where the volunteer who's the chairman of the Board of Selectmen has, you know, doesn't have the bandwidth to continue the growth when the budget is getting up over $30 million and $40 million because they have a day job too. So there's a point where things need to start bringing professionals in these different areas so that they can manage the growth as well.
So when you're talking centralizing, you're talking hiring people for, I mean, I guess I'm confused when you're talking,
Laura,
about centralizing the government.
Can I ask, there's a line of people behind
you. Sorry.
Before she leaves, can I just say this? I'm sorry, because I think this might be helpful if there are other departments that have the same thing. it clearly isn't our intention to knock anybody's legs out from underneath them, right? We all respect the authority of the appoint of the elected boards, and we did try to maintain the integrity of that. And so what would be really helpful as you're reviewing this draft, if there's language in there that's of particular concern where you feel like that's being given away disproportionately to the town manager, if you can, you know, point directly to that. This is not the final draft, and we're not taking a vote tonight. We really, you know, despite what people seem to think, we do value your input, and you are voting on this at town meeting. That's not lost on anybody here. So it would be really helpful if you can point to those particular areas, and that's something that we can take another closer look at. Okay. And, you know, maybe we need to change some language. This, again, this is not the final draft. So if you could do that, that would be really helpful.
Thanks, Jean.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm sure you can. Gary Russell, 5 Lakeshore Drive. So my issue or questions are, and I'll be frank and curt because I see the line behind me. So my issue is with the appointment versus the election of the town clerk, or any official for that matter, when it comes to the appointment and the differentiation. I noticed when you went through what you found in terms of the applicants, the applicant flow is one of the reasons that you said, oh, this would be good for an appointment. And I get that. But otherwise, it was mutually inclusive. I didn't see a differentiation in the two. And secondly, I question the wisdom of consolidating that into appointments overall, because I think it reads a sort of incestuous, you know, it just doesn't sit well with me personally. And I'm sure that by the reaction when you were talking about the data here in the crowd, it seemed that everyone agreed that, well, that's irrelevant to the discussion of electing versus appointments. And I found it also interesting that the only slide you had up there was with the appointment piece. It had nothing to do with the, you know, the pros for the elected versus that.
Which for I the thought, town clerk?
Right, which okay. I thought was interesting. I thought, you know, it's an old, I've done a few presentations in my time. It's an old sales trick that I've used myself. When you see that, I would like to see them both. And I think a compromise could be that we vote, or at least vote for an elected official. And if that doesn't work, then we can go to the appointed. Then the fallback would be the board would then have the ability to appoint someone. And again, I would have a lot more to say, but I'm trying to carve that up. Because I think a lot of people here clearly, and the votes historically dictated, that they do not want every position or the consolidation of the appointments to just a few people, even if those few people are elected. Does that make sense? Do you have questions?
Yeah.
So if the board is electing the town clerk right now, right? Or if that's you,
so
that's
currently
the charter
elects the town clerk. The charter states that the town clerk is an elected position.
Correct. And you're recommending that it's appointed.
Correct.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
So why are we moving to that when it seems like overwhelmingly everyone here, at least, if I don't mean to speak for everyone, thinks that we should be electing them and continue down that path? Because I see, I don't understand how that squares with the streamlining of the charter, how it's necessarily mutually exclusive in that case.
I think one of the things that we took into account, in addition to doing, we did go through a pro and con for elected and appointed.
Sure, I heard you say that.
And we actually, when we were in the meeting talking about it, we had a whiteboard. We listed everything one after, you know, side by side, yeah, to see what was going on. We're also understanding that the town clerk position is becoming a lot more regulated in terms of what they need to do.
Sure.
I will be the first to say, and I'm sure everybody on this committee would agree, we got a phenomenal town clerk through this election this year, and he's doing a wonderful job. It's not that we're saying anything about the job that he's doing. We just think that if you have an appointed town clerk, you can require additional, you can have requirements for what the job will entail.
See, I don't understand how you can't if
you
elected.
Can't if it's elected.
Well, I mean, I guess I shouldn't say that. I do understand that, but I think we should be able to elect someone who is qualified, who fits those qualifications, right?
If they decide to run, you could also, there are other towns where
and
have,
they may not,
have
but they may.
People that have run and been elected, right, and never show up, but they take the salary. So just because the town clerk is elected does not mean
Well, look no further than our current president. I mean, I understand. He clearly does. I don't care what side of the fence you're on. He clearly doesn't have the qualifications to do the job like some other folks would, even our representatives. I understand that point, but I still don't understand why you would appoint versus. I don't see the distinction being so clear that that you would write that into the charter over the what everybody else in the town clearly wanted and has voted on time and again.
So let me clarify. There were two votes, two articles that were brought forward
right.
to change the town clerk from elected to appointed. The first one happened back in 2010.
Right.
And then within, they could be, it passed at town meeting to make the town clerk appointed.
Then.
They had to wait an entire year to go to the annual town election, at which point it failed.
Correct.
Because there's a reason we're having a special town meeting more closely
right.
to the election. The second one was last year. And what I had heard on the floor predominantly was there's a charter review process going on now. Let's not jump the gun and push this forward at this time. Let's let the charter review process do their job.
Sure.
And so that's, so I don't think it was a, we don't want this elected or appointed. I think it was,
but that's your recommendation.
The town said, I don't feel that the town said, we want this elected. I felt the town said, we want to let the Charter Review Committee go through their due diligence and make a determination and make a proposal.
Okay, a proposal is different.
Yep, can I comment as well?
Floor is yours.
I wanted to point out that a lot of the feedback related to elected versus appointed town clerk came from the Personnel Committee, okay? And they are strongly in favor of an appointed town clerk for a variety of reasons.
Are they elected?
They are appointed.
Wow, isn't that funny? Well, I find that, you see what I'm saying, right?
Yeah,
this is exactly
what
I started.
Can I finish what I was going to say?
Sure, of course.
All right? I thought we decided we weren't debating, but.
I said I'd agree too.
Among ourselves.
Correct.
Yes.
But I'm just trying to show you some of the feedback that was given to us. So there's a lot of stuff that came into the Charter Committee, you know, as Darlene was pointing out, that she wanted to ensure that the people that come to the forums are heard.
Right.
We also have to listen to the boards and the committees that are also providing input. And some of that is different.
Sure.
So we are faced with people on one side and people on the other, and we're trying to come to the best solution. So we understand fully that there are a lot of people that support an elected town clerk. I'm just pointing out that there are others who do not.
Who are appointed. And that's I find that odd.
They're not all appointed. There are,
sure,
there
but
are,
it,
there
would
are
you
reasons
say disproportionately the boards that are appointed?
Do you know what the primary reason is? Why they would favor an appointed town clerk?
Because Ashland does it?
No, it has to do with the salary administration plan and how the town clerk is paid. Okay? So
I don't understand how that has anything to do with it.
Because there's no way to regulate it. So if you go to town meeting,
right.
Okay.
So an appointment would be, I find that strange.
Yes, an appointed town clerk would then be subject to the personnel policies of all employees. And they would have, they have pay grades and things like that. Right now, the town clerk goes before town meeting and votes themselves a raise. And as Pam pointed out.
Let me clarify that right now. There is an article at town meeting that states what the town clerk's salary shall be.
But anyway.
When you have somebody who's up for election and, you know, people can have varying amounts of experience, possibly none, possibly lots of experience.
Sure.
But they have to be from town, so it can't, you're not
right.
grabbing from a pool outside of town.
Right.
That person comes in and regardless of their experience, their salary will be X, Y, or whatever's in place. So, you know, that's one of the angles that or one of the aspects, I should say, that's being considered there.
But I think it's true, but I think the same could be said if it was an appointed position. The grades are then appointed or adjusted by the people who were appointed. So if I'm appointing you and I know Pam,
okay.
and I'm like, I think Pam's great. I think she deserves
no,
X.
Then because the salary administration plan has ranges for positions.
Of course.
So if
just
somebody
like
doesn't have experience, you can bring them in at the lowest end of the range. they're not going to just come in at what the last clerk was making at that time.
Well, sure, but that's one position, and I get the salary. That's a very valid point.
What other position are we talking about?
We're not talking about any other position. I'm only talking about the town clerk.
Okay,
I'm just I'm just saying.
All right.
This is, if that's the concern, if that's going to break Hopkinton's budget, we're in trouble beyond that.
It's about lining up somebody's salary with their qualifications. If I was the CEO of a company,
sure.
And I was making $300,000.
I'm a recruiter, by the way, so I know this very
well.
No, I'm saying, but if
so
I was making $300,000 and I retire, and the person coming up behind me was much greener and much newer, of course the board of directors wouldn't start them at the same salary that I left at. So what we're saying is if the person's appointed, their salary can be commensurate with their experience and their qualifications. And by the way, there are a lot of qualifications to be a town clerk. And as it is right now, if you run for the election, you can be elected and completely not qualified, and then you have to spend the first year or so of your time getting qualified.
Sure, so. And that goes without saying. That is the danger of elections, and I understand that. But I see the other way of disproportionately towards the appointments, it could go the other way just as easily. The people who, there are bans, but you could easily, if I was unqualified, appointed, you could easily, just as easily, put me in the top band because you appointed me. Just as easy.
Can I just say a couple things? One is, I do want to say, this is probably challenging because our town clerk is here listening to this whole conversation. And I do want to say how much respect all of us have for the job that Connor is doing. As for the town clerks that we were fortunate to have before him, we have really been lucky here. And I think this is the position where it was the most difficult to remove the personality from the conversation.
Sure.
So what we're trying to do is make a workable, efficient, productive structure for the town in the absence of who's sitting in whatever particular chair. So I think it's really hard in this case because we all feel so strongly about the people who have been in that chair. I think it's just a point worth noting. But the other piece is that an appointed town clerk, so the position is increasingly professional, and there are a lot more requirements that the town clerk has to meet and certifications that they need to get, and Connor's working really hard, doing a great job of achieving all of those things. Beth is right, or several people have made the point there, that's because of his character and his integrity. Another person could be elected town clerk and do none of that, and you would have no recourse for 3 years. If you appoint somebody who, you know, is needing to keep up their, first of all, you can mandate that they have those qualifications going in, but you can also, if they're not keeping up with that, then they're having an annual review. So the town has more control over that person through the appointed approach than it does over the elected approach, or more immediate control, I guess you could say.
Yeah, more, I was going to say this.
Which, you know, you may think that's good or you may not think that's good, but when we got to that part of the discussion, what we felt really strongly about, because we all really do think that as much independence as can be preserved in the town clerk's office is really important to the position, that's why they are a little bit different, and so they would not have their review, the town manager would not be part of that review or review anyone in their office. That would all be done by the Board of Selectmen, who, you know, is elected and does report to the town. So that, again, I feel like I'm always the one that talks about how we came to whatever compromise. Those were the factors that we considered and how we got to this recommendation, which again isn't final and we're not voting on tonight.
The last thing I'll say on that is I appreciate you guys saying that. I know you guys work hard too. I'm not trying to bust your chops about this relentlessly, but I still see it that if you appoint me, there's obviously a reason you did. It's not just because I'm qualified. There's some connection there. And you're less likely to hold that person accountable given the appointment, I think, than an elected official who can then...
appoint means hire.
No, I understand
what it means.
I mean, there'd
be a whole
I want to thank you for trusting your elected officials. So
yeah.
You seem to have a lot of trust in talking about things being incestuous. And
right.
The personnel committee comes up with their recommendations because they're appointed.
Right.
I challenge you to go and find the last person who went for the personnel committee or went for any other committee who was not, where there weren't multiple people going for a particular seat and they were denied. We're always open for volunteers. And if you can show me the last person who was going for an uncontested seat in an appointment and was denied, I'd love to see it.
Well, uncontested is different. Sure. That's... What? Sorry. There's a line.
Thank
I'll
you.
I'll come back if there's more time.
I just want to say, I hope we're catching a lot of things and maybe we'll whittle down the line, but...
Dale Danahy, 25 East Main Street. I have a few concerns, and I don't think I'm going to change anybody's mind sitting there, but I just thought I'd voice them anyway. And again, the elected town clerk versus appointed. I like elected, and we've done well in the past. It just reminds me of years ago when we had an elected highway superintendent, Bob Bartlett. Our roads have never been as good as they were when we had Bob Bartlett. So anybody sitting in this room that remembers Bob Bartlett knows that as an elected official, he was awesome. We decided we needed to appoint our highway superintendent, and we went through a ton of highway superintendents. And our roads have never been as good as they were when we elected our highway superintendent. So I'm not so sure by changing this to elected, from elected to appointed, we're going to get a better caliber. Just because other towns do it, and I know you guys looked at a lot of towns, and you know, just because somebody else does it doesn't mean we have to do it. Hopkinton is unique. We might have the same demographics or median income as other towns, but I've lived here a long time. I've seen a lot of changes, and we do things and we have done things that other towns don't do, and we're very successful at it. And it's because we get the caliber of person that cares, the Connors, the whomevers, the Bob Bartletts. So I'm just thinking that I like it the way it is because it's worked. For the reasons that you listed, they're not up there and I don't have them here. My other concern is we're building an empire for our town manager. If we're dumping five more departments that have to go to him. My concern is, if you look at the past history, since we've had a town manager, we've replaced 28 employees, 32 employees, 25, I'm not sure what the number is, but an awful lot of finance directors, everybody. And I don't want to add five more. I don't want to add a library director, a board of health agent, and whomever else. I didn't get my list written quick enough, but there's an issue there, and I don't want to hazard to guess what it is, but there's an issue, and I'm afraid that if you make the Board of Health and the rest of these other people have to report to the town manager, there's going to be more issues and more positions that we have to replace.
Hi, Mike Manning, 32 Briarcliff Drive. I have two questions or two comments. The first is the process when it comes to charter, comes to town meeting. Is it completely thumbs up, thumbs down, or can there be amendments made? This is like the whole question tonight is the popular thing for an elected versus appointed, or if somebody can somebody come up saying, I want to amend it to make it an elected position. Can they do that at the town meeting?
So the answer is yes. They can. Anyone at town meeting, just like any other article, can make proposals for amendments. I would say, please, since I will be sitting there trying to write the language to implement an amendment, if somebody has an idea that they want to propose an amendment, please allow the moderator to know that, perhaps let me know it, so that there can be language to implement it. So it's not, just take as an example, if somebody wants to bring a motion to change the town clerk from back to elected, assume that the proposal remains the way it is and they want to make a motion to change it. It's not just a matter of crossing out the word appointed and writing elected. The whole provision has to be moved to a different section of the charter under elected officials. There's a whole lot of other provisions that would have to be changed. So it's not going to be easy for me to do that on the fly. So if somebody intends to do that and I know about it ahead of time, I can be prepared. So that's just a matter of self-preservation.
It wasn't for me. It was just with the comments going around, it was just a question I wanted to ask.
Absolutely. Just like when we do bylaws, people make proposed amendments, and that will certainly be part of the deliberation process of the town meeting. And as far as what is the rest of the process, whatever is voted at town meeting will then be submitted to the Attorney General, like our bylaws are, except on a faster track, because they only have 4 weeks to review it. And if the Attorney General's office approves of what we've done, then and only then is it eligible to go to the ballot. And so then it will go to the idea, it's lined up so that there will be enough time so it can go to the ballot at the regular annual town election.
Okay, thank you. The second comment I have is about Appropriations Committee. I am a member and the chairman of the Appropriations, and one of the proposed changes is that at town meeting that the Board of Selectmen present the budget rather than Appropriations Committee. Maybe I'm a little biased, although I don't know if I necessarily like standing up in front of the town saying we're going to raise your taxes. But on the other hand, even before I was on the committee, I always liked hearing another board or more. I'm not going to say it's independent. We're appointed by the Board of Selectmen, but it's an independent view of this is our vision or this is our view of the budget, good or bad. I can give an example. When before I was the chairman, the previous, an earlier chairman went up, we were proposing there's going to be a school, a DPW, and a library, and when it all said and done, here's the slide that's going to show here's the impact on everybody's taxes, and everyone was aghast, and the Board of Selectmen go, how can you put that slide up at a town meeting? And I thought it was a great slide because it's being transparent. This is what it's going to be versus perhaps the Board of Selectmen or the town manager doesn't want to show that slide because these big projects are going to cost money, but it's honest. So you slightly get a different view of how the budget is by having Appropriations actually not just a write-up that's proposed that who maybe some people will read it, some people won't, but if you stand up in front of the town and say this is our view of the budget, I think it's a different view other than the Board of Selectmen.
So I'll speak as another member of the Appropriation Committee. And we did go around about this particular piece, whether it's Board of Selectmen or Appropriation Committee that would, or town manager even, that would present the budget at town meeting. And what it came down to eventually was, whose budget is it? Is it the town manager's budget? Is it the Board of Selectmen's budget? Or is it the Appropriation Committee's budget? And we ultimately came down to it's the Board of Selectmen's budget because the town manager sends it to them. They're an elected body. They approve it and send it to us. And we tend to investigate the pieces of that budget, but don't necessarily own it other than making recommendations back to the Board of Selectmen. So I understand the concern definitely about having a separate view that's an independent, it's a watchdog that's making the report to town meeting, and I hear what you're saying.
My view is like maybe the library is a good example. There were definitely, you know, there's members of the Board of Selectmen who were helping get that through, and if that person happened to be the chairman or maybe the finance person and they present the budget, how would they want to present it if this is their pet project that they want to get through? They would, maybe the cost wouldn't be as highlighted in the presentation. I'm just saying this is a good independent view to have the Appropriations Day.
I want to make one comment. I agree that the recommendations by the Appropriation Committee are very helpful for people at town meeting. And I think when Pam talked about that, it came down to who owns the budget. And I think that from the perspective of the Board of Selectmen representing the public, they're elected. That's why we went with, you know, they are controlling the budget. But I don't think it precludes Appropriations from making a recommendation. at town meeting, and I think that it's still valuable. It's just, we weren't contemplating getting rid of all recommendations from various boards like we usually do. Do you agree? I mean, you know, that would still be there.
Okay, I just wanted to give my view on that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Eddie Schaub. I live at 1 Birchwood Lane. I moved to Hopkinton about a year and a half ago with my husband, and I've been so excited to become a part of local politics and to be a member of my community. To that end, I was recently appointed to one of the vacant positions on the Personnel Committee. I just do want to be clear, though, that I'm not here representing that committee in any way. I'm just here as a concerned citizen. I've listened to a lot of the concerns that were presented by a lot of my fellow residents and a lot of the comments presented by this committee. And to start with, I think it's so great that we're having such a healthy conversation about it. We've been talking over each other a little bit, but it's been very healthy, I think. I'm here because I am also concerned about changing the position of town clerk to appointed from elected. Now, when I first learned about this being a consideration, being a thought again, I'm recently new to town. I thought, for the most part, a lot of the trade-offs were just six of one, half a dozen of the other. You know, you could say that we could have elected an individual who was awful and terrible, never showed up to work. But you can also hire a person who ends up being awful, terrible, never shows up to work. Well, at least when you hire them, you can fire them, right? Well, we have a recall procedure. We're not stuck with our town clerk for the entire time. We can recall them. You have some concerns, of course, about salary as to whether or not we would necessarily pay the person with the right amount of experience, the right amount of money. But with an appointed person, it's in a range, and that range can be decided by the board. Now, of course, not to say that the board would make a terrible decision, but we're in a unique position here to see not what type of town we want to live in now, but what type of town we will live in 10 years. That's how long the charter will be around for. Now, Gary, I thought, brought up a lot of really great points about the type of community we want to live in, and whether or not we want to look at the benefits of having an elected position over an appointed position. Now, to that end, I did a little bit of research, but finding social studies about the benefits between elected town clerks and appointed town clerks is a little, it's slim pickings. But I was able to find one preliminary draft, not for citation, by the University of Wisconsin, called Comparing Elected and Appointed Election Officials, the Impact of Selection Method on Policy Preferences and Administrative Outcomes. And what this study did is it looked to different towns in Wisconsin. And I know we're not in Wisconsin. Like, we don't live anywhere near Madison. But in those towns, in small towns across Wisconsin, they compared those towns that had elected town clerks and appointed town clerks. And they asked a few questions. What were the benefits? What were the detriments? Problems? Solutions? And they did find one particular thing that was true, absolutely true, about having an elected official over an appointed official. With an elected official, the town was more involved in voting. When you have an elected official, when you have an elected town clerk, people show up to vote. Now, I was able to watch the video from the last town open forum about this issue, and a lot of people did express apathy that, you know, it would be just easier to appoint, to just hire somebody who they thought was qualified for the job, because maybe people don't show up for it, maybe people don't run for it. But saying, okay, we should give up and make it easier isn't necessarily the best solution. I would rather live in a town where everybody is involved and has skin in the game. And when we elect a town clerk, it's better for all of us because we are encouraged and forced to look at ourselves and ask, how do we want our town to be run? So to that end, I would encourage all of you to reconsider that. And I do have a question. I'm not sure if either the committee or even counsel for the committee can answer this question, but there was some mention by Gary about how we do have, if it's a job, you can have certain qualifications for the job. But we can't necessarily, I think somebody might mention, we can't have qualifications for the position. My question is, I understand that the United States Constitution does, of course, have requirements for a presidency of the United States. Is implementing a requirement for the qualifications for town clerk, has that been preempted by state statute? Is that why we would not be able to do so?
That's definitely you.
so yes. In a word, yes.
How so?
State law governs the election process and does not allow other than to state law provides that, that you can only elect registered voters mm-hmm. are only eligible to be on the ballot, but we can't specify any other qualifications for access to the ballot.
And that's due to field preemption?
That's due to field preemption,
okay.
Yes.
I was just curious about that.
Yes.
Must be a lawyer.
I just didn't look into it. So thank you for explaining mm-hmm. that.
Yes.
And that's all. Thank you for listening. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I want to thank you all for all the work you put in. And I've heard a few nice words about me up here, too. Well, I've been in line. It's been nice. I also really wanted to make a comment on, I was really, really glad to see, and I've told Pam this when she's come to my office to make copies of the charter or to look up bylaws or look up town meeting votes, that I'm really glad to see all that housekeeping has been cleaned up on the little errors riddling the charter. I'm really glad to see that the financial and budgeting process has been streamlined. I really wanted to start out by saying that I was really glad to see how much positive change there was there. I have my position on, I think that a number of, I think the board should be able to maintain power over their appointed directors of their departments. And I'd also like to say to a point that was made earlier in the discussion, I've been concerned about how the committee has taken public viewpoints on any of the issues about the charter. Coming to a number of the meetings, I've heard a lot of terminology to the effect of the average resident there's no way they could tell if someone's qualified to do a job. There's no way we're gonna listen to how they recommend we're doing this because it's going to possibly stop everything that we've worked on. We might as well throw everything out. There's a lot that's being done that's great. I don't want to see thrown out either. But it's not throwing out the whole charter to listen to what residents of the town want to see. That was really all I wanted to say for now. Thank you again for doing all of the work you've done. I know you've done an incredible amount of work. I've looked through your packets and I've read your minutes, and kudos to you. Thank you.
Thank you. No, but I've got two people behind you that haven't been up at the, okay, go for it. Okay.
So mine again, this time is really directed at town clerk. We liked Mr. Zedek, we loved Mary, we loved Ann, we loved Jerry, Connors. This is totally not based on personalities. I've heard over and over again, the job is getting more complicated, there's more certifications. When we had the last charter, the certification process was already in place, and Ann got certified, Jerry got certified. I think those are all things where people can attain to. I go to the town's website and look up town clerk. The mission statement says, come introduce yourself. Register to vote, get your dog license, get our current leash laws. Outside of having an enormous election that this young man did very, very well, I have not seen anything that's changed in 20-something years where I can go in and someone can go in and pick up a death certificate, someone can register to vote, I can still get my dog license. But that the fact that the mission statement on the town's website says, come introduce yourself, get your leash law, your dog license, register to vote. That really synopses what the job is on a day-to-day basis without election time. And that's kind of where I'm coming from. I don't see where it's changed and what other certifications and demands are coming that aren't already being met. I know you spoke on that. I don't know if you had any.
I think that, first of all, I'm not aware of when the certifications went in place, but there are certifications for the position.
Absolutely, and I know the last two town clerks had them.
They did get them, yes, yeah. You're absolutely right. But when you're electing somebody who doesn't have them, you don't always know that you're going to get somebody that is planning on doing that. And I think that trying to find the best candidates for positions. Mm-hmm. Ideally, they'd be from our town, mm-hmm. But trying to find the best candidates for positions, I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
And I know, town. You know, from being involved in town for a couple decades and very involved, I've watched appointed positions actually be jockeyed for. You know, come on, vote for this person, you know, he'll make a change, this person will be different. Going up against actually some extremely qualified people and people who may have even been in a position before to come in and fill gaps, and watch someone with no qualifications get appointed because they were jockeying for a change. So it's like, where are the qualifications there? I mean, it's the same thing. If you were gonna, on a couple cases I can list, if you took resume to resume, it's like, holy, what did you just do? You know, and sometimes it's been said, well, I just want to give a new person a chance. You know, I started off as a new person. That, you know, is that different for appointed then?
I don't know. Were those positions overseeing something that's town-wide and gets paid?
I was going to ask.
Yes, it was.
Are they salary positions?
$70,000 a year? Or,
no, they weren't salary positions, okay. But there were still positions that are appointed that should have experience. And when people have come to the mic at selectmen's meeting and basically said their resume, what they've been, and you're watching, you're like, oh my God, you just picked the person who's had no experience at all and doesn't, and stuff like that. Or, you know, find out like, well, yeah, we're kind of jockeying around, we wanted to change, you know, we didn't want this person back or we didn't want that. Then it makes it seem like it isn't impartial, and it's what, you know, what Gary referred to, that, you know, we can appoint bad people too. And I think there has been some bad appointments, and you need those people have to be as qualified as elected people, whether or not there's a salary or not. I want Laura to be as qualified for her being a commissioner as Jay is as a director, you know, and doing their job and worthy of getting my vote, whether it's, you know, and I want that same kind of look as someone who might be being appointed by the Board of Selectmen or being hired by a town manager. I mean, none of us or anyone are in these positions like the Pope. I mean, they're transitional, and you know, he's the only one who has a job till you die. And I think a lot of this is based on personalities. I get input from the personnel committee, but there's been a lot of input from the community saying the same thing repeatedly over and over again, and that seems to be get disregarded. And the same thing when you look at actual resumes and qualifications on appointed positions, sometimes those are totally disregarded and going with something that's been jockeyed for.
So I want to clarify, when you're talking about appointed positions with the disregard, these are to boards or committees, rather than
that, but they are.
Because when with our view of the town clerk, where this is on par with the town manager, the fire chief, and the police chief, and you would go through a search committee. You wouldn't just look at a couple resumes and say, yeah, let's go with this one.
And in comparison to that, there are actually some towns, and maybe some that you've compared to, that their fire chief, their police chief, their town managers all have to be within the town or within a certain thing.
Or move within a certain number of
certain
years.
Range. And I think in a lot of our cases, at least the town manager's case, we haven't done that. You know, we've brought in people from a great distance in, you know, our first town manager's case. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there's something where bringing somebody who's at least somewhat regional, somewhat local, their ramp-up time, they know the community, they've been invested, and they feel an emotional investment, and it's not just a job. Mm-hmm. You know, Connor graduated from college with a ton of background in this. He had already interned in the town hall. It wasn't just a job. He felt very vested into a community he was raised in, and I think that's a lot of the times where someone raises their hand wanting to be appointed, or whether they want to be elected, they want to go on a non-paying committee, or they want a paid job. It's because this community means something to them. And when we say, well, we can just cast a bigger net, sometimes that's not been very successful for us. I mean, that's about it.
Yeah, I think we could probably cite failures on both sides, though,
oh,
whether
absolutely.
It's elected or
and
appointed.
I mean, in the past year or so, I've watched it a couple times, very apparent, and it's like, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, positions being jockeyed for, and saying, you know, I just want to change, or this, that, and then, you know, watching in one position, seven candidates, and the six having way more qualifications than the seventh that got chosen. And I was like, wow, how did that just happen?
Hmm. Okay.
Sorry, no.
Thank
right.
you.
Could,
no, no.
Make, go ahead.
Yeah. I'm watching the line grow again.
Yeah.
All right. I'll speak really quickly. I
do you need me still up here?
Um, I think just to kind of reemphasize, I think it was something that Todd just mentioned, just a couple of things real quickly. You know, we're not trying to say that, you know, an elected position, you're always going to end up with a worse candidate, and an appointed position, you're always going to end up with a better candidate, right? We're not trying to say that by any means, as Todd just said, there'll be good and bad on both sides. What we tried to do was, again, removing personalities and look at it from an element of saying, in the long run, with personalities removed, where's there the least amount of risk, and where's there the greatest probability of failure? We weighed back and forth, and we came up with a conclusion that we put in the charter and put forward as a recommendation. The other comment I would say is just around the process around gathering feedback. You know, I'm one of those that was one of the members of the public that's part of this group, which started a year ago, back in January. I'm not sure I really realized what I was signing up for, you know, when I joined that. But I continually be impressed with the amount of feedback that and information gathering that we've done, the number of interviews, the number of questionnaires, as well as the public feedback. And so I would just say, please don't just feel that there's a disregard for that feedback. It's very much been regarded, and there's been a lot of discussion and compromise and change to recommendations as a result of that. And we've had to walk, I think, the tightrope of, it's not our it's part of our responsibility is not just to make sure that we would put forward a recommendation that we are absolutely certain would sail through without any discussion and any concern. We are, our charter, our what we, our responsibility, right, is to come up with what we feel is the best recommendation. We certainly don't want to make a recommendation that we know would have no chance of being voted. That doesn't help anyone either. But it would be a responsibility to have weighed the input and to present what we think is, you know, we are recommending as a path forward. But this debate and this discussion is all great to come up with ultimately what the town wants to agree to go forward with. But I just kind of wanted to.
If I can quickly support what Kurt said, and I promise quickly, many of the boards and committees that and town employees that we spoke to aren't here tonight. But I just, you know, there's a lot of conversation about listening to the people in the town and what they have to say. And I just want to remind you that they also are people in the town, and they have had a lot to say. And so they're not necessarily standing here arguing the opposite of a point that might be raised, but it doesn't mean that we haven't incorporated that feedback as well. And I know we all have a tendency sometimes to feel like, unless you do what I say, you didn't listen to what I said. And I, you know, it's just hard. So I hope all of you understand that what we really have tried, as Kurt said, to listen to everybody and to come to what we think is a workable compromise. But again, this is not the end of the road, and in many ways this is our test case before we go to town meeting. So this feedback is very important and very helpful. And now I'll stop talking so you can give more of it.
I'm Dan Terry, 9 John Matthew Road. I'm also a member of the Parks and Rec Commission. I'm vice chairman, member of several other committees in town. But I've got a question, a comment, and also a recommendation that comes from our committee. But my question is, within the duties of the Department of Public Works, it says in the proposed charter that the DPW will maintain and control all the parks and rec property. Was that something that is that a change from where we were before?
No.
Or it is not a change from where we were before?
That is, currently the DPW is operating under a special act. So to be clear, a special act is something that was passed by the legislature, but it only applies to Hopkinton. And the process is, town meeting requests the special act, it goes to the legislature, and the legislature adopts it. So DPW currently operates under it's three special acts, each one amending the one before. And that language appears in the special act. We've always found it a little awkward that the special act was not aligned with the charter. Doesn't make sense to have a different set of rules for them. We would just incorporate it into the charter so that the charter is more comprehensive. So all that language was in the charter.
Okay.
In the special act.
And now it's in the special act.
And it's just been incorporated into the charter.
And I don't know what the right approach is, but as a practical matter, that's not necessarily how it is handled here in town now. There are definitely properties that the DPW assists and does maintain along with Parks and Rec, but there are Parks and Rec properties where Parks and Rec has accepted responsibility to maintain the property, and it budgets that way and all that. So I think this is a departure, even from a budget standpoint. That terminology changes the way we would approach the budget with this, and I think it also suggests that there's an ability to move money from one department to another, again under the control of the town manager. That's what just in my reading of it and how things are working as a practical matter.
So I have a quick question for Ray.
Uh-oh.
No, it shouldn't. Because it's in the special act and we've moved it to the charter.
Yes.
May we make changes or propose changes to the verbiage that we pulled from the special act and then have that be the overall overriding rule?
So the answer is yes. The charter would take priority over any statute. So any statute that is inconsistent with the charter. So if you made a change to the charter, that would control over this whatever's in the special act. So if you're suggesting, this is not something I don't think the committee has ever considered, yeah, that what is in the special act governing the DPW is not in fact what is being done, now's the time
to let us know.
Align the language so that we're not creating unnecessary illegalities.
I think I did.
Well, give the specifics.
Yeah, yeah. So we need to know the specifics. Okay.
Okay.
All
right. I'll be happy to do so, and probably enlist the DPW. The Parks and Rec director as well. So that was one question I had, and then I want to thank you all for entertaining me at your meeting last week and allowing such a back and forth with all that. I found it very educational. I did bring the comments back to the committee, but I'd like to reiterate that our vote didn't change, mm-hmm, and that our recommendation as it relates to the to the five different places would be that for appointment of a Parks and Rec director, the board would appoint with input from the town manager. Let me first say that we would very much welcome the input from all departments of the town, and especially the town manager, as it relates to any of these things. So that would be ideal. And part of the reason why I think that support the changes that I'm going to read in a minute, which are consistent with what I had emailed you, Pam, mm-hmm, in the past, is that there's so much that's open to interpretation in the way things are written now that I think that we would rather see them in the basis for the interpretation to start at another point of control, I guess, a little bit more in the direction of the elected officials and less in the direction of an appointed town manager. So those are appointment, the board appoints with input from town manager, supervision, the board supervises in consultation with town manager, goal setting, the board sets goals with input from town manager, evaluation, the board performs evaluations with input from town manager, and for discipline, we feel like the board should discipline. We did vote on that. It was a unanimous vote. I'd also like to say that the members of the Parks and Rec Commission also serve on dozens of other committees in town, and I think that input should be considered by you guys.
Could I ask for a couple of clarifications?
Mm-hmm.
So when you talk about appointment of by the board with input from the town manager, so currently the town manager has a process in place through the HR department for soliciting applications and screening applicants and reviewing those things. Are you suggesting that should be different?
No, and again, would welcome the input of anyone in town hall, and we feel strongly that everyone should.
But to be clear, are you? The input is different. The process that is used for hiring people for other employees is it's turned over to the HR director, and the HR director runs the whole process, and then ultimately picks the identifies the key candidates, and the town manager then reviews those people, interviews them, and what have you. So are you suggesting that process should be different or the same?
A little bit different than what you're saying. I guess what I'm suggesting is more involvement by the board, and just a little bit of history on that is I've been on the commission for 5 years. I've been involved in seeing three Parks and Rec directors hired. The first two, that process was very, very much led by the HR department in terms of screening the initial resumes and determining what an ideal candidate looked like. Those candidates lasted 4 to 6 months apiece once they were hired. We have a current Parks and Rec director who the process very much more involved the Parks and Rec Commission. I know I was a member of the screening committee. There were two of us that were involved in it. I was very, very much involved in it, and I feel like we got someone that was very committed to the town, very committed to the department, and is going to be a long-term strong employee for the town. So yeah, I guess I am suggesting that a different process be considered, or that the process that you're describing isn't quite as rigid as you're suggesting.
Okay, thank you for that clarification.
Okay. And then, you know, finally, I just with this whole process, as I sit here tonight, I know it's hard to sit there, and you guys have put in 10, 11 months of hard work on this, and this is your baby. But as I see people coming up here tonight, I see most of what your reaction is to argue with us and not take it as input. And I think the risk that you run when you do that is I took a quick count, and I counted six folks that suggested strongly and made great cases and came out tonight to suggest modifications. I saw one person that was neutral on the process. I think you got an uphill battle if you're not going to consider some of these changes.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Ken Weissmantle, 145 Ash Street. First half of my comments, I'm going to speak as chairman of the planning board, and then I will transition to speak as a resident at 145 Ash Street. I have two questions on the planning board paragraph under the appointments. First of all, you've added the words "in accordance with personnel policies of the town." I will admit I haven't read them probably in a long time. Maybe if they came before town meeting, I read them at one point or another. If that has to do with you will advertise and maybe it's a salary range, that's probably okay, because things ought to be consistent from that standpoint. But if it's thou shall do it and really say that you have to have the town planner and they have to have a master's degree in this and whatever, and set the qualifications for the planning board to appoint their town planner, then I think there's some negotiation that needs to be done. So I don't know how restrictive that document is as to where it is. And I don't know, has everyone on your committee read it recently? I mean, you're requiring it to be part of it. I would hope that somebody has read it in order to know what you're requiring.
So I don't believe it. I should say, I don't believe it's in the town bylaws. I think it's, when we think of personnel policies, we think within the HR department. So
I read that with a capital P and a capital, or two capital P's, and that would give me the idea that there's a document called personnel.
Oh.
Okay.
Don't leave them.
Yes.
Okay, well, I'll take some homework and I will read that. Then my next question is under the appointment. It says may instead of shall appoint the person. Can you explain why you made that change?
You may choose not to appoint anybody.
I had the same
right
question.
Now, right now, it says shall, and you don't have somebody appointed. So
No, we have Elaine appointed as town planner. We never rescinded her appointment.
Well, okay. Fair enough. But the point is, it's up to you to decide to do it.
Okay.
You're not there. Nobody can file a lawsuit compelling you to make an appointment.
If it's may.
If it's may. If it's shall, somebody could file a lawsuit compelling you to make an appointment.
Okay. These are the following questions. In all my organizational mm-hmm. business classes that I've taken, even my military leadership training that I was subjected to, authority and responsibility go together. You got to have the authority to do something if you're given the responsibility. As a planning board member, I've been given the responsibility to do those functions by the voters. I need the authority to carry out those duties. And I think what you're doing here is severely limiting that, and I'll talk about it in a little bit more. The second thing that I noticed in this document, you have the town manager doing all the evaluations. That's what it says. If you do that literally, that's all he's going to do. And the span of control, another thing that you learn in business school, that won't work. So you're practically putting together a document that just won't work in the practical thing. The town manager should be looking at his 5 to 10 reports, and that's it. And then, you know, somebody that's working as a clerk gets evaluated somewhere else down the line. But that isn't the way you got the document written. My DPW experience. I got elected to the DPW just as we were doing the special act and getting rid of it. when I was kind of a caretaker commissioner on that board, we had so little input on what the director did because he didn't work for us that, quite frankly, the secretary never published the minutes for us to review. She took notes at our meetings, but I bet you there isn't even, I challenge everyone to go find the minutes from all of our meetings that we had. And without the minutes, did the meetings exist? Did the policies that were enacted survive? I don't know. That's another reason why you have to have the authority mm-hmm. to carry out your elected job. And I think the charter is deeply taking away from it. To kind of end up on the planning board met Monday and unanimously voted for me to oppose the charter portion tonight in this presentation for basically the reasons of authority and responsibility. I think you'd also kind of look to our neighbors to the east of us, Framingham. They had a problem with the town manager and the Board of Health and who was appointing the Board of Health agent. And that got to be in the papers. I don't remember all the details of it because I just looked at it for a while, but it was for a couple of months until eventually they took it away from the town manager because the elected board couldn't do their work. And that might be what you think is an extreme case, but if you take away the authority from the people that are responsible, you're going to do the exact same thing that happened to the DPW, who couldn't appoint the DPW director in the original charter, an error in the original charter. We fixed that with a special act and we did away from the DPW board. Quite frankly, I think that's a mistake, but that's how we fixed it at the time. Now, transitioning to my...
Before you transition.
Oh, okay.
if you could send me what you recommended for the charter, for the planning board,
sure.
In terms of the specifics...
Basically, we looked at Mr. Terry's email that was circulated around, and while we didn't vote on each particular items, for example, I'm paraphrasing myself, appointment... Board appoints with input from, I would say, HR, as opposed to maybe the town manager. But town manager could be, if you define town manager as the rest of town hall, which is, seems to be what you've kind of done in this document. Supervision, the board supervises with the assistance or in consultation with the town manager. Goal setting, board sets the goals with, when we'll take input to the goals. Evaluation, we provide the evaluation with input from HR. For example, everyone said, well, geez, you know, a board chairman, I can't go out and do that. Well, maybe the HR person goes and collects all the stuff that comes up with a draft evaluation to present. That could work. That's another way to solve the problem that you're trying to fix. Right. And I think it would work a lot better. And then with a HR person involved in that, which would be more the, I'll say, a corporate model, I never gave evaluations that the HR department, as when I was managing a bunch of people, that they didn't review my draft. You know, they wanted to make sure that everything was within policy, et cetera. And that's not a bad idea. Discipline, you know, the board disciplines with input from HR. You'd never try to fire somebody or even discipline them without having HR holding your hand. I mean, you know, that's, you know, that'd be stupid. I mean,
yeah.
Anyway, so those are kind of my inputs on that.
Thank you.
Now going for myself. I find it hard that I rarely agree with Darlene Hayes, but I find it hard.
You say that too often, I think.
I find it hard to find a lot of the input that first forum came in here. And, you know, the first forum, I didn't talk personally about the town clerk appointment versus elected. And I purposely didn't do that because I was kind of waiting to see how things turned out. And I think Connor's worked out very well. And I've dealt with him on elections and stuff like that. He takes input, seems to get the job done. You know, he still has an assistant town clerk that was qualified to do the job. I mean, he had the job for a while. And I think you might want to look at the model that we have here and what the model we used to have when Bunny Nealand had the job. We always had an assistant town clerk that did and was capable of doing the job, basically. Now, we also have control. Let's say that we set the town meeting election, you know, we give the salary of whatever enormous amount of money it is today, and then 2 weeks later we elect somebody else's town clerk, and, you know, they're, you know, a 19-year-old right out of high school and, you know, maybe doesn't have the qualifications, and town meeting, at the next case, or the person doesn't come to the job, maybe it's an older folk, doesn't come to the job, town meeting can go and make the salary a buck.
A year later.
Or call a special one if it's that bad.
It has to be an annual?
Yeah.
Okay. It's a year later.
But the recall provision is open if the recall position is
a fairly hard bar to do.
Is.
And it was set that way at the last charter commission. But you do have the opportunity to correct the decision. You know, we're talking about, if worse comes to worse, a relatively $50,000 error, and I hate to say it, we probably make those kind of errors in this town more often than not. So anyway, basically, I think that if the authority portions of the elected boards don't get revised back to something else, I will be in active opposition to this charter change at town meeting with signs and at the election.
Can I speak to one thing that's
sure.
been said by you and a couple other people? The fact of no input has been received. I think it was you that actually said something about the cemetery commission being a good elected position to retain, as it might be a jumping point for other people to get involved in elected office. We listened to that, we heard that. We didn't change any of the boards that were elected to appointed, even though that was a consideration. So there is input,
okay.
We listen to you.
Okay.
I just find it a little bit disheartening to hear person after person say that we didn't listen.
Okay. We did listen.
Okay. One of the other things I kind of said is, why are we electing commissioners of trust funds? I mean, you know, I tell you, there's almost nobody that cares. I mean, to find a position for that job, and I spend a lot of time trying to find positions for jobs, or good qualified people for it, it is just, you know, it's kind of, who cares? I mean, you know, there are a lot of boards that could get appointed.
And that was something that you were saying, Ken, at the last meeting. You were going through a list that you thought could just be wiped out from the elections and just made appointments. We also heard other people coming up and saying they wanted more elected positions and fewer appointments. And so, you know, we evaluated that, we discussed it all, and we said, look, if there's, you know, if it's something like that, let's just go with the way it is, unless it's trouble right now.
Okay.
Rebecca? You snoozed.
Hi, Chris Dietz, Alexander Road. Have a couple questions coming at you. Mm-hmm. You know, during this whole charter review process, I heard a lot about streamlining and making government more efficient, but I have heard nothing on the need for checks on power in government. So my question to you is, as a group in reviewing the charter, did you consider checks on power in government?
Such, can you give me an example?
Just in general.
I'm going to look to the committee, because I'm not even sure fully.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to say that we did look at that, and I think that some of the recommendations that have been made, there were no recommendations, correct me if I'm wrong, that everybody reports to the town manager, of things of that sort. And that was exactly for the reason that you're saying, is we were trying to balance the power. I mean, that's kind of where we were going with it. So it is something that we've looked at. But I think part of the puzzle that's missing here, and it goes to when Rick was saying that we did listen and we're hearing that we didn't listen, there are other opinions that are coming in that maybe you haven't heard that we have, that may contradict some of the things that the people at the forum provided. So we have faced with trying to balance that. So, for instance, there are some places where people feel they need more authority, and there are some where you think they need less, and we are trying to ride the fine line in the middle to try to make it as fair and equitable as we can. So, yes, we did consider that, I think.
Yeah, I think the bigger thing is just that our form of government, where we have the elected groups that are all responsible to the voters. We do have employees. At some points, they're responsible to those elected boards. And then there's town meeting in the end, that before something like the charter or the budget or anything is approved, it's not just from one person or one committee or board saying that that's what they want to implement. It's by vote of the whole town meeting. So I think that our system has those checks and balances built in already, thanks to our founding fathers 200 plus years ago.
Oh, okay. Well, speaking of our founding fathers, I have a hypothetical coming at you. Just for the sake of argument, assuming that town clerk was appointed and that the town clerk reported on one or more Board of Selectmen members to the authorities for violation of the open meeting law, what would you guess what would happen to that town clerk?
I think if, personally speaking, if the Board of Selectmen tried to get rid of him without just cause, that would be an HR lawsuit nightmare. Because in order to fire somebody, you have to show just cause.
Even if they're appointed?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Also, I'd like to say that I think the town clerk position is a key position in this town, and it's highly visible in a politically partisan town like Hopkinton. The town clerk is just more, the town clerk does more than just issue dog licenses. The town clerk oversees our voting process, which is very significant. and I hope that you will reconsider keeping the town clerk position elected, as that will serve as a check on power in this town, which is already top-heavy with appointed positions. And also, I want to ask, is there any date yet set for special town meeting?
It's my next slide. January 30th. The Board of Selectmen set the date last night.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Just one thing on that last comment.
Yeah.
Town council, if I'm not mistaken, every 3 years, an elected town clerk cannot participate in running the town election. Is that correct? Because
yes,
he's on
correct.
The ballot?
So the town clerk cannot participate in running any election in which the town clerk is on the ballot. So once every 3 years, it has to be turned over to the appointed assistant town clerk anyhow.
Okay. Hi, Rebecca Roback, 3 River Bend Road. I kind of wide-ranging comments, but I'll keep them brief. And I have one question to start. And this is related to the topic we've been discussing about the town manager hiring the person who is reporting to the elected board or appointed board. The wording is that those particular committees can appoint based on the recommendation of the town manager. My question is the recommendation of the town manager binding? And I ask this because I know in the school department, the superintendent can recommend to the school committee that they hire certain people that the school committee is to hire, but they have to follow the superintendent's recommendation. So is that binding or not?
No, it's not binding.
Okay. All right. So what I would recommend, just for your process, is there is a lot of discussion about this and about the fact that people think the town manager is potentially becoming too powerful. You do have, and there is a lot of desire to keep these commissions and these committees autonomous. During the town manager review process, I would recommend you see if you could seek input from those boards of that this town manager may now be hiring people. And I'm sure that's going to be a public meeting nightmare. I know already these reviews are. But if indeed the town manager is getting a little more authority, then I think those committees should be able to give input to the Board of Selectmen as they're doing their review.
So
just
like
a recommendation.
360.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Correct. Moving on to a different topic, the budget. I hear that you're trying to streamline and that you've kind of removed the dates that had been in there for the different departments to get their budgets in. And while I'm guessing the intent of that is to potentially move things a little bit earlier in the year, my concern is that without having any deadlines in the charter 5 years down the road, that may slide the other way. And so I think it's dangerous not to have some deadlines. You put deadlines in for the capital articles if they have to be, or the warrants have to be in 90 days. I'd recommend some kind of no later than date. You can still maintain that flexibility, but you don't run into a situation where people are really stalling the budget because of whatever reasons may be happening 5 years down the road.
Yeah, I mean, the idea is that by October 1st, you have to set it. And at that point, you've got buy-in from three separate
okay.
committees who've said, you know, if it gets to the point where it's so far back, the Appropriation Committee says there's no way we can get this done, you have to move it further.
So the October 1st is kind of your deadline then to make
right.
sure everything's in place. Okay,
yeah.
that makes sense then. And then third, again, a lot of discussion about the town clerk and whether it's elected or not. My comment is less about the qualifications of the person. I think the fact that the town clerk is elected right now maintains some integrity in that position. I think that to appoint them, as someone has suggested, the person may still feel like they have to answer to a town manager. I think by electing that person, it keeps the process clean. It keeps the integrity of the democracy clean. And so I would recommend that stay as an elected position. I'd also, because there's been a lot of controversy here, to help with special town meeting, suggest that you guys draft language in advance for if someone wants to have it be elected so that you don't have to worry about trying to do that.
That's
on the
fly. One we are already planning to draft.
All right.
We talked about that at the last meeting.
Okay, good. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to have a last call soon.
I just had one more thing I wanted to add about the salary for the town clerk. I heard there was some concern about the potential of a unqualified clerk coming in and making the same amount as a previous clerk who might have been far more qualified. I know in my case, I'm making less than the clerk before me did. It was decreased during the town meeting. The only concern I could imagine is when you see a clerk retiring and new ones coming up with whole clean slate, in which case the town can choose at town meeting to then decrease the salary for the upcoming fiscal year. In the case that it would be two individuals running and the town doesn't know which is going to get it, then if at least one of the people's qualified, hopefully there would be enough faith in the electorate to say that this person's going to be elected. We can either lower it a little bit for a starting salary, or we can leave it where it is. I don't see a situation where someone would be able to come in with zero experience and town meeting not saying they're not making near as much money as the person who came before them.
I think, just to answer that question, the election happens 2 weeks after we set the salary. So in any case where there will be a new town clerk elected, whether it was this past year or 3 years before that, you're setting a salary before the person has even started the job. Or in the case if there's a if there are two opponents, before the winner is known.
That is true.
So,
but that still leaves you an instance where you don't have a wild card coming in necessarily making the same amount, which was said earlier when the question was brought up.
Mm-hmm.
So I partially just wanted to clarify that and say that while I was, well, there was no one in line. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Do I have anybody else? Going once, going twice? Sold. So finally, the Board of Selectmen have, let me get to the right page. The Board of Selectmen have voted to hold a special town meeting beginning January 30th, 2017 for the purpose of town meeting approval of the proposed changes. They are not necessarily these proposed changes you have seen tonight. This is just the draft that we got out for the forum. Upon approval at special town meeting, if it so happens, the charter as accepted will be forwarded to the Attorney General's office for approval. Only after the Attorney General has approved it may it be placed as a ballot question on the May 2017 annual town election. Thank you to everyone for your participation tonight. We'll spend our meetings prior to special town meeting analyzing the input from tonight and making final changes to the proposed charter. Copies of both the warrant article containing the proposed charter and the report from the Charter Review Committee will be available electronically on the town website and in hard copy through the town clerk's office, the Hopkinton Public Library, and the Senior Center at least 14 days prior to special town meeting. We'll also be continuously updating our website for new drafts now that we have a first proposed draft out there so that anybody can see any changes at that time. And thank you for your participation.